Welcome, I'm Dr. Janine Bowring, naturopathic doctor, and today I'm discussing leptin versus lectin. So I had a ton of questions about what the difference is. People get confused. I used to get confused myself about the word lectin and leptin. And you may have heard me discuss leptin at length, so depending on where you may be following me. So I've talked about this at length on YouTube, The Science of Weight Loss. Leptin Resistance is the name of that show. So be sure to check it out. So when we talk about leptin resistance, it's so important to know why this is happening in the first place. And in terms of being resistant, when our brain no longer is getting that proper signaling that we are in the fed state and we're okay, we've got enough body fat to keep us warm, what happens is that the brain no longer receives that proper signaling and then we become resistant, which we can see in this diagram here. And unfortunately, then the brain is telling our body to go and search for more and more food. And this is how we can become more overweight. The more white fat that we have, the more that leptin will be released and sent to the brain and more of that leptin resistance. So it really is something that we have to tackle and overcome, especially if we're trying to lose that weight, trying to get the hormones in balance. But if you missed it, like I said, check out my entire episode, The Science of Weight Loss, Leptin Resistance, so that you really learn about and some great tips that you can use and start right now and today to get that leptin resistance under control so that your brain is getting the right chemical signaling so that it knows exactly what state it is in. Now let's talk about lectin. So lectin with a C, and the problem with lectin is that it has nothing to do with leptin. Well, it does. It is partially related, but they're completely different terms. So lectin is actually a protein that binds to carbohydrates, and this is something that makes plants more resistant to pests and to different pathogens, and it can actually cause digestive upset. So in a moment, I'll talk about some of the most commonly ingested lectins that you've probably heard about. And, you know, there's a lot of news that sort of surfaced about lectins a couple years ago. And a lot of, I think, in my opinion, some misinformation as well. But we want to ensure that we're not ingesting too many of the lectins because this can lead to leaky gut syndrome. And as we can see here with leaky gut syndrome, that's when those tight junctions have opened up in the gut walls. And this is something that we want to avoid because certainly to have proper digestion, to get the proper energy from our food, to ensure that we're not in that inflammatory state, we want to make sure that those tight junctions are nice and tight together. When those open up, what can happen is that larger undigested food particles can pass through those gut openings and can cause a lot of inflammation and hence the leaky gut syndrome with inflammation, which then can lead to autoimmune disorders. So thyroid disorders, it could be lupus, you know, when we're talking about autoimmunity. So really important that we have the proper gut function, and lectins can actually make this inflammation and that damage to the gut wall even worse. And so, you know, going back to my own childhood, this all came to, you know, my own realization that, and my mom used to always say when we were preparing green beans, not to eat them raw. So as you're preparing them, you know, as a kid, I was like, oh, they look so juicy and tasty. I'm going to try this. And my mom forbade me to eat them raw. And that's because of the lectins. And because she knew, she said, it's toxic if you eat it raw, they have to be cooked. Well, lo and behold, that's because of the lectins. So mom was right. And one of the most commonly known lectins is gluten. So again, a lot of people have developed a gluten sensitivity issue, whether they realize it or not. So this isn't something that, unless you're celiac, of course, that I would recommend, but sometimes by coming off of the gluten and allowing the gut to repair, especially if you do have leaky gut syndrome or IBS or Crohn's or colitis, coming off of that lectin, especially if you're eating, you know, gluten products every day, is really important to allow for the digestive tract to heal and allow for those tight junctions to heal up again. And that's why a lot of functional medical doctors will always, you know, talk about coming off of some of the lectin foods. So whether that's the gluten is a big one, some dairy products as well. Also, peanuts have lectins if they're in their raw form. Corn as well, and as well as the nightshade family. So that includes potatoes and tomatoes, as well as sweet peppers, they all contain lectins. Vegetable oils, which you've heard me talk about before if you've been following me, especially the PUFAs, the polyunsaturated fatty acids, are very inflammatory. Well, one of the reasons could be because of the lectins that are in the oils. Beans, as well as legumes, can also have, you know, and be a problem and problematic if they're not cooked or soaked because of the lectins. So that's why, you know, in my opinion, I think the whole lectin story got blown out of proportion. I think we can still personally, you know, eat these things, but if we're in that state of inflammation in the gut, or if we have an autoimmune disorder, it's probably a good idea to stay away from them for a little while until the gut is able to repair itself. Then you could slowly have a little bit more of these things, but that contain the lectin. However, if you cook or you roast, so for peanuts, and I asked a colleague today, you know, oh my God, I'm in trouble because I love peanut butter, organic, natural peanut butter. Is it okay? And no, peanuts usually in peanut butter are roasted peanuts. So if you roast them, then you're going to decrease that lectin amount. So whew, yes, that's a good news. But also if you're cooking your corn, if you're cooking your potatoes, if you're cooking and soaking your beans and your legumes, really important to decrease the amount of lectin. So that, and also if you sprout your beans and like alfalfa sprouts, and you're sprouting some of your grains, then that would be a way to decrease the lectins as well. So I hope that cleared it up for you. I hope you learned something new. Please be sure to share this video with your friends. Also give me a big thumbs up. I really appreciate it. And if you're new here, welcome. I'm Dr. Janine Bowring. Make sure that you subscribe to my channel, but also click that bell. So turn on those post notifications and click all notifications so you get my new and latest uploads every single day, helping to educate you about your health, doing things naturally so you can be the best that you can possibly be. And remember to always take good care of your health and do it naturally. Thanks for joining me today.